Hey, welcome to a very special Groundhog Day edition of Razorback Reels. I'm Adam Roberts.
And I'm Aaron Emsall.
We've got some great reviews for you, and of course, we'll talk about the Super Bowl weekend, so we have some football movies to recap, so stay with us. Hey, welcome to a very special Groundhog Day edition of Razorback Reels. I'm Adam Roberts.
And I'm Aaron Emsall.
We have a lot of great reviews for
Pretty
you.
good, pretty good, not bad.
Yeah, we had the Super Bowl yesterday, of course, I'm sure everyone watched. So we got our five, or not, maybe not five favorite, but five football movies you should watch to kind of get you out of the postseason funk.
Sure.
Yeah, so make sure you stay with us throughout the show. Hey, welcome back to another very special episode of Razorback Reels. It's Groundhog Day.
Yeah, Groundhog Day. What do you know?
I know. I just love Groundhog Day. It's my favorite holiday besides, you know, Christmas and my birthday and all those.
And all the other major holidays,
Right. So it's one of my favorite February holidays. It's in the
it's
top
my
five.
top, yeah,
Yeah,
my top
top
five
five.
February holidays as
Right.
well. I agree.
Speaking of the number five, we also have five football movies. I'm sure after the Super Bowl, everyone's a little disappointed season's over, but we have some movies to kind of tide you over till August. So make sure you stay with us here on Razorback Reels.
Once again, the eyes of the nation have turned here to this tiny village in western Pennsylvania.
All right. Well,
that was our edition of Groundhog Day, doing our replication of Bill Murray's great Groundhog Day movie.
Right, and of course, some of us were smart enough to rent the movie before Groundhog Day. So if you go to Hastings and it's not there, that's my fault. Sorry about that. But of course, you know, Groundhog Day, courtesy Columbia Pictures. Thank you for that clip. We have a. You know, we have four movies that we saw. At least I liked all of them, and like we said, Super Bowl. So we'll get on with the Best Picture nominee, the final Best Picture nominee review we'll have, Milk.
In all 50 states.
I know you're angry! I'm angry!
You're not like most homosexuals, I are.
Do you know a lot of homosexuals, Dan?
Much has been talked about Harvey Milk's portrayal by Sean Penn in this, and Milk is a Best Picture nominee, and it's worthy of being a Best Picture nominee. It tells a very good biopic version of the life and times of Harvey Milk, which is the screenplay written by Dustin Lance Black, is heavily influenced by the documentary, The Life and Times of Harvey Milk, that won an Oscar in the early 80s for Best Documentary. And this movie kind of starts off of Harvey Milk and him actually at 39 getting ready to turn 40 and how he wants to change his life and do something in his life that he felt like he's never done anything up until. And so he moves to San Francisco and decides to become an advocate for gay rights in San Francisco and stand up and become a politician. And it kind of chronicles that whole journey and what he had to go through it. And there's some great supporting performances. Sean Penn's good in this. I have a little thing that I think he puts a little too much I Am Sam in his portrayal of Harvey Milk to kind of hurts the overall feeling for me in this. But I still think he did a solid job. And I think this is a really good movie. Do I think it's a great movie and do I think it should win Best Picture? No. But there's a lot of good things in this. There's some great supporting performances by, I think, especially Emile Hirsch, James Franco, and Josh Brolin, too, who got nominated. I don't think he's the best. supporting member of this movie. But I did think he was good. Maybe not a nomination, but he was still really solid.
Right. I mean, I really like Milk. I'd probably actually go with the A-, but, you know, it's all these nuances that only we care about.
Sure.
And our loyal viewers, of course, every week. But I did really enjoy this. I thought it was reminded me a lot of All the King's Men. You know, Sean Penn was in the remake, of course, only with different ending, left me a little bit more upbeat and hopeful. So this is a movie that you definitely go to for, you know, inspiration. It's a great political movie. So I really, really enjoyed this. I'm rooting for Slumdog Millionaire. I wouldn't be too upset if this won Best Picture, though. I wouldn't be like, no. I'd just be like, oh, okay.
Well, it's certainly a good movie. I mean, I wouldn't be upset either, but I do think that maybe it's not. I do think there's maybe two other films that I would prefer over this in the Best Picture nominees. It's really a good story of talking about his fight for Prop 6, which is really relevant because we just went on with Prop 8 in California.
I was in California over winter break, and every conversation anybody would have started out with Prop 8. So it's a huge deal, and with all the Academy members living in California, obviously, I think it has a very realistic shot at being a surprise pick for Best Picture.
I agree. I mean, Dustin Lance Black, who wrote the screenplay, I think is the odds-on favorite to win Best Adapted Original Screenplay. In this. And I think he did a good job of turning this story. You know, I haven't seen the documentary. I've watched bits and pieces of the Oscar-winning documentary. But I think he did a good job of putting it all together and making it cohesive.
Yeah, because it's so hard to tell stories like these without, you know, turning it into, you know, just making him out to be a saint or anything like that, or adding in too much bad stuff to make him look too human. I thought it's a very tough balancing act, and I thought it was done very well in this. Sean Penn, of course, was terrific. I mean, I haven't seen The Wrestler yet, but he'd be my pick for Best Actor if we had to vote right now.
Like I said, too much I Am Sam, I think, in his portrayal, because I've seen enough of The Life and Times of Harvey Milk to feel like he's not. Okay. He doesn't quite come across the same way, but whatever. Yeah. That's nuances,
and of course,
again.
Milk is up for 2 Silver Reels Awards for Best Picture Drama and Sean Penn for Actor, so you can go to RazorbackReels.com and vote now for or against him, depending on your preference there. Well, movie not starring Sean Penn saw a little bit lighter fare new in town with Renee Zellweger.
The plant's losing money. Who's going to handle this?
I can do it.
Joan, book Lucy to Minnesota this weekend.
Minnesota? What is that?
We call that snow deer.
How bad can it be?
When her company needed to reorganize, Lucy was right for the job.
Management at Monk Foods has sent me here to usher in a new phase.
All right, new in town. I mean, I was surprised I liked this. The plot is pretty obvious. You know, this woman from the city goes to a small town. She's supposed to shut down the factory. She doesn't tell anyone. There's one single man in the entire town, and he happens to look like Harry Connick Jr. And I just let the whole plot go for me from there. You've seen this so many times. First 5 minutes of this movie, I gave up on. I was like, this is going to be horrible. But as it went on, all these just hilarious scenes kept cropping up. And I mean, there's one sight gag in the first 10 minutes that when you see it, you'll know what I'm talking about. I thought it was terrific. I was just almost out of my seat laughing. And then, you know, you go on for about 10 more minutes where it's kind of, and then you have another just hilarious thing happening, just cracking up. So this movie is rated PG. And I'd have given it a soft PG-13, but I guess there's debate about that. But it'd probably be fine for most of the families. So if, you know, you're wanting to see a movie, you have to take some kids along with you, I would definitely recommend going to see New in Town because it's something everyone will enjoy. It's just that sort of movie. I mean, I only gave it a C+ because it wasn't anything terrific. It's, you know, it's pretty much, I think, a Hallmark Channel movie. I think that somebody honestly did write this with the Hallmark Channel, you know, one of their TV specials in mind, and then somebody else came over and rewrote it and decided to release it. And I'm not saying that as a slight, but I really did enjoy this a lot more than I thought I would.
Good for you, Adam. Yeah, I can admit, when I saw the preview, was not interested at all. It looked like my last very pick I wanted to see. I don't know, just didn't look appealing to me. If there was a PG movie out there, I still say Paul Blart Mall Cop is your PG comedy.
I like this a lot better than Paul
Blart. I haven't seen it.
It's a lot funnier.
Haven't seen
it.
I don't know.
And it's a lot less mean,
perhaps,
too.
Perhaps so.
Even though apparently nobody in Minnesota wears high heels. I was really surprised.
It's a law. I think it's a law.
I have some friends from Minnesota, and I guess when they come down, this is their one chance to wear heels. So it's a lot of fun. But
I don't know.
All right, movie.
Moving on to a action
something
kidnapping
completely
movie.
Different.
Taken.
There's someone here.
What?
Oh my God, they got Amanda. You're coming.
All right, listen to me. Go to the next bedroom, under the bed.
Tell me when you're there.
Now, the next part is very important. They're going to take you. I don't know who you are. I don't know what you want.
All right, Taken, starring Liam Neeson. It's pretty much every father's worst nightmare slash action fantasy. You know, his daughter goes off, she gets kidnapped, and he has all the... He's like Jason Bourne in maybe about 20 years is kind of what I saw him as.
Crippled Jason
Bourne. Yeah, Jason Bourne with a little bit, you know, a little bit of a crick in his back, getting on in years. You know, his daughter's kind of estranged from him, but goes to Europe, just goes on this action rampage trying to save her. And I thought it was... I mean, it's not as bad as a lot of other action movies as we've had on there. You know, it's no Max Payne. It was a little bit goofy at times. I thought there were a lot of weird tone shifts. Like halfway through, it turns into like something about the war on terror, maybe where, but then it kind of drops that plot line.
Well, I agree. There's way too much ludicrous stuff going on in this movie. First of all, you got Oscar Schindler, a little aged Oscar Schindler, Liam Neeson, and his annoying daughter, played by Maggie Grace, who used to be on Lost and who was an annoying part of Lost, so they got rid of her off the show, and she's just as annoying in this movie. And she gets kidnapped, which, if you know anything, and this is French written and Luc Besson.
Really, French written.
Yeah.
Because everybody that's French in this movie is evil.
Yeah.
So,
well, this is part of the guy, also the same guy that did a movie called District 13. It was a French movie that came out, was a high-paced action movie, and Luc Besson, of course, also did Transporter movies. He's the one movies.
Right.
So it's the same kind of style, this ridiculous action.
The action's not as good as Transporter or anything like that, though.
Nowhere as good. And the problem with this is that you just don't believe that Liam Neeson is the one kicking this much butt. He does not come across as a guy that's capable of doing it. And, I mean, he just doesn't feel like he is. I mean, Matt Damon is more appropriately aged at being able to do this. Liam Neeson, not so much. Yeah. And the subplots in this movie, the whole singing subplot, it's ridiculous and annoying, I felt like.
I think I
ruined the movie.
I like Liam Neeson this role better than you did, I think. Because when it sets it up with his relationship with his family, it does really seem like he's this, you know, government guy, spy, sort of estranged. I think if you had Matt Damon in this role, it wouldn't just feel quite
maybe
as right.
Somebody
his
older.
His face is a lot more,
I agree.
A lot more pain in it.
Well, I agree,
really
you need somebody
like,
older.
I like that.
But maybe not, I don't know, he comes across too decrepit or something.
If
and
he just would have straightened
family.
His spine up just a little bit, it would have been fine. And what was his, the actress who plays his wife?
Famke Janssen.
Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't like her performance either, and I like her normally. I didn't think she came around. I thought everybody else around him came across well. Uncle Rico is one of his friends, a little spot there. Didn't like him really either, so... I like some of the action scenes. I like some of the smaller stuff, but overall, there was too much stuff distracting this movie and making it not very good. C-, just because it's just barely watchable, I think.
Yeah, I think that it's just
better than
slightly,
Max Payne.
Slightly above average. I think
better than Max Payne.
Seen so many horrible action movies lately. I think I was surprised to see when that's
better than Transporter 3, probably.
Much
too.
Better than Transporter 3.
Yeah,
no question there. But all right, if you are looking for a horror film,
PG-13 horror,
I always am, we have The Uninvited.
Yeah? I had a dream. There were children. I think they were trying to warn us.
Your daughter got it in her mind somehow that your fiancé killed the family she worked for.
Look at this. We need to find out who Rachel Summers really is.
I want you to think about whether or not you are ready to be part of this family.
All right, The Uninvited, starring Edward R. Murrow, Elizabeth Banks, and
Emily Browning.
Yeah. She plays a 14-year-old this movie. She's actually 20. I thought she did, a really good job. She has exactly the stereotypical PG-13 horror movie look, where you have sort of an interesting face.
Oh, I thought she was great. Yeah. I really liked her performance in this. And the movie is kind of like all about, she is put in the situation where she maybe sees her mother's death and she's, trying to remember, and starts off in like a mental hospital, and then everything kind of goes from there, and you're trying to unravel, like, is it the stepmom, and it's kind of like a lot of things you've seen before, but then it's got a nice little turn in the movie that we're not going to talk about.
I really liked it.
It's got a really nice turn.
I started to see it coming. I was like, oh, really, are they going to do this? This is going to be awesome. So this is, it really elevated it above all the other PG-13 horror movies that I've seen lately.
Yeah, and I think this movie's carried by Emily Browning, and she does a good job being able to carry this movie. A typical actress would have made it too over the top or too
annoying. It's a much tougher role than you would think.
Yeah, and she does a good job. She was in Lemony Snicket, A Series of Unfortunate Events. She was the one that played the girl in that, so... I, you know, it's pleasant. Half, beginning of the movie, there's, of course, 2009's Line of the Year.
I don't think we should say it or not. But go if you're the type of person who sneaks in the movie, sneak in for the first minute, and it'll be fine.
Some really cheesy lines, but, you know, you may not think you're going to stay with this, but I think you'll be pleasantly surprised at the end.
Started out not liking it, grew on me. I ended up really liking it.
I agree, same way.
Well, as we said, we're going to have some football movies for you after the break.
So here's our trivia question with the Super Bowl theme. What movie features a terrorist attack on a Cowboys-Steelers Super Bowl game? Steelers. We'll see the answer.
Wednesdays at 7 on UATV.
Sports Advantage, Thursday at 9 on UATV.
Hi, I'm Judy Shepherd Misset, founder and CEO of Jazzercise. Join us for Jazz Cardio Strength Stretch. Each half-hour program combines cardio, strength, and stretch routines for a total body workout and tips on health, nutrition, or exercise. Thousands of people have tuned in to Jazz Cardio Strength Stretch, and we hope you will too.
Weekdays at 8:30 a.m. on UATV.
All right, and the answer is Black Sunday, a 1977 action hostage terrorist movie starring Bruce Dern and Robert Shaw, where it actually features Bruce Dern driving a blimp into the Super Bowl. So,
interesting.
Yeah, luckily that did not happen last night, so good deal.
Yeah.
Good deal, phew. But it's actually an kind of dated 70s movie, but very something you would never see today with Palestinian terrorists flying a blimp
into
it.
It hit too close to home.
Never see that again today. It's that crazy rebellious 70s movie, but it's an interesting movie, kind of boring, but interesting.
Well, we found five football movies that are not boring, so if you're so sad that the season's over, I mean, Pro Bowl. So we've pitched some movies out that might tide you over until football season starts again.
Someday the team's up against it. Brakes are beating the boys. Ask them to go in there with all they've got. Win just one for the Kipper. I don't know where I'll be then. But I'll know about it. I'll be happy.
Newt Rockne, All-American.
Win one for the Gipper.
All the way back in 1940, and I'm sure you recognized George Gipp.
Our 40th president, Ronald Reagan.
Ronald Reagan.
Yeah, so that's the only part of the movie I've ever seen.
It's the only part anybody's ever seen.
So as long as you see that part, you're set. That's all that matters.
Until Rudy, this was the last film that was allowed to be filmed at Notre Dame on campus.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, this is just a classic. You have that classic line. When you talk about football movies, I think this is where you really have to start.
I guess, if you say so. I was thinking more Harold Lloyd, College or something.
Yeah, I guess he did have the...
I haven't seen that either. But
I haven't seen Horse Feathers with the Marx Brothers. So out of the movies we've seen parts of, this is where to start.
Start here.
Well, the one that we have seen, Brian Song from ABC.
I love Brian Piccolo. And I'd like all of you to love him too. And tonight, hit your knees. Please ask God to love him.
Billy Dee Williams there, made-for-TV movie.
Starring James Caan as well as Brian Piccolo.
And Brian Piccolo.
If you like a little tears with your football, then check out Brian's song. Right. It'll definitely bring tear to your eye.
You have, like, the list of movies where men are allowed to cry. You have, like, The Yearling, and you have, you know, Brian's song is on that very small list. And I had to read, we had to read this in class in seventh grade like 100 times, the script for this. And so I know it by heart and I'm a little tired of it, but it is still really good. I remember the first time I saw it, I liked it. So, I mean, this is, we probably have given away the ending by now.
I think people might know.
I'm sure if you know your football history or Chicago Bears fan, you already know how it ends up anyway. But this is something I'd recommend, especially if, you know, your girlfriend, your wife is so sick of football and, you know, you have another football movie, go ahead and get Brian's song and that's something she'll sit and watch with you.
The relationship between the great Gale Sayers, who's considered one of the greatest running backs, you know, of all time, and with Brian Piccolo, who is his backup. And, it's a true story. It's heartbreaking because not only because it's true, but because they had a solid friendship and bond
there.
They had
a bromance.
And there's a sad ending. Yeah, one of the first TV movie bromances before Brody Jenner, but... Yeah, it's a good movie.
Right. And then Rudy is, of course, another heartwarming football movie. We seem to be on a theme here. Back in 90... Yeah. You know about the last Hobbit to be carried off the field at Notre Dame.
Never been a Hobbit carried off the field since, believe it or not.
Well, of course, that's one of the, you see the whole story coming when you sit down, but when you have a sports movie, you pretty much always do. So this is just another one that just gets you off your seat, gets, you know, the tears flowing. You just love Rudy, rooting for him the whole way.
Oh, I love this movie. I saw this in the theater in 93, and believe it or not, I was just a youngin', and I was wanting to play high school football. I remember thinking, I can do it. I was little, I can play high school football if you just get me in there. This movie
so many dreams crushed because of this
exactly.
movie.
Exactly. Rudy screws people's lives over, make you think you can be a great college football player if you just give it a lot and heart and try and strength, but no, it didn't happen. Didn't play college football. I'm not part of Bobby Petrino's squad right now.
Wow.
So.
It's like all the Woody Allen films where you think that really short, ugly guys can date all these beautiful women.
And it's not true.
Then you grow up and learn.
Just the magic of Hollywood. So, But it is a very good movie. You got Jon Favreau and Vince Vaughn in this small little part. Right. So that's an interesting little twist to this.
But nice to see Vince Vaughn in his pre-Norman Bates era before he really went to the...
Before he screwed over Robert Hitchcock movie, yeah.
Of course... Let's see, Jerry Maguire, of course, we're talking about movies you can see with other people who aren't into football.
Football
I'm not sure how I came up with this list.
Chick flick football list, Adam.
Hey, I like Jerry Maguire, so let's roll the clip.
I like Jerry Maguire.
Very important thing. Are you ready, Jerry?
I'm ready.
Just want to make sure you're ready, brother. Here it is. Show me the money.
All right, Jerry Maguire, of course, with the Oscar-winning Cuba Gooding Jr., which is,
Whose character, Rod Tidwell, played for the Arizona Cardinals, which is very poignant since the Arizona Cardinals just played in the Super Bowl.
Very good tie-in.
Very good tie-in there. And, of course, Rod Tidwell, like you said, won the Oscar, and it's been all downhill for Cuba since then. So, sorry, Cuba.
This is sort of the... Okay, Renee Zellweger is still around. Tom Cruise is making a comeback.
Kinda.
Cuba Gooding Jr. is
still floundering.
Sadly, still around.
Don't you think that Cuba should be down there? Should have been at the Super Bowl yesterday, like signing autographs as Rod Tidwell or
I
something.
Just get his popularity a little bit back somehow.
People remember. Oh yeah.
As great as Daddy Day Camp was, I think that Jerry Maguire might have been the
a
peak.
Better.
Yeah. It's sort of a really short peak of a very, like Mount Everest, and then it just goes straight down.
Yeah, this movie, although is a chick flick, is also a fun football movie, the insider look of the sports agent. And this has got classic line after classic line. Of course, Show Me the Money. It's also got the You Had Me a Hello. And I mean, this has got some great Bruce Springsteen song for this movie. Like,
there you go.
The Wrestler, he just did one for The Wrestler. But I love Jerry Maguire, and it's hard to admit.
Best nominee, of course.
Yeah.
Lost to The English Patient.
Yeah, The English Patient. Yeah, don't get it, like Elaine would say. Yeah. But
it's so boring. Stupid guy in a stupid desert.
I love Jerry Maguire, yeah. And the little kid, what's his face? He never had a career.
Whatever happened to him?
Never had a career, but he had a great arm.
We're going to do a 10-year retrospective in a couple of weeks, so then we can look back to 99 and see what happened. But that's 96, of course. We're going to move on to probably my favorite football movie, The Waterboy.
It's a good one.
And then attack. Can you handle that?
I tried.
Just going to try.
What's the matter with you, boy? You too stupid to do what your coach tells you? No.
No what?
All right, I mean, you got Happy Gilmore, you got Billy Madison, but I always pick The Waterboy as my favorite Adam Sandler movie. I just thought it was hilarious.
I agree. Yeah. It's he had a great streak there at the beginning, Adam Sandler, with Billy Madison. Billy Madison, Happy Gilmore in this. But after that, he kind of started tailing off a little, Nicky.
Well, he had The Wedding Singer the same year.
Oh, so, yeah, true. Yeah. Wedding Singer as well. But this is it's really fun because there's a lot of football action in this movie. It's filled with football action.
Probably
it's also,
more than all our other movies combined.
Yeah, the most football of all of them. But it's filled with tons of good comedy bits. I mean, silly comedy bits. But comedy bits nonetheless. Lawrence Taylor is in this movie as well. It's got the classic, "You can do it!
You can do it!"
Of course, the next line was edited for TV. But it's got some really good stuff, funny stuff. Some people maybe think it's ridiculous. Yeah. Kathy Bates, Veruza Balk and her freaky looks. But
hey,
it's really funny, this movie.
Yeah,
I guess,
Bourbon Bowl. The announcers during this, I still remember, it's one of my favorite parts. And this is the last game of the season. You got to lay it all on the line. You know, something John Madden would bring up every other phrase.
If you like to make fun of Cajuns, this is Cajun humor. It's got great Cajun humor in this. It's a fun movie to watch with a lot of football. So I don't know. If you're a football fan and you hate this movie, I think you're just a little too stuffy.
There's something
let loose.
Something wrong with you, maybe. I don't want to judge our viewers too harshly.
There's a lot of other good football movies that we didn't get to. Movies like Varsity Blues that I know a lot of people love. I actually really like that movie as well. I think it's a good portrayal of high school football in kind of a teen comedy kind of a way. Of course, James Vanderbeek, you haven't seen him really much since. So it's all been downhill since Varsity Blues. Friday Night Lights, which is a really good movie, but I think even a better TV show, by the way.
Yeah, The Longest Yard, not the Adam Sandler one.
Yeah, the Burt Reynolds one, which is really good. There's The Program, which is a good middle 90s college football movie that I think with Omar Epps as the star running back, that I think is a really good movie to check out.
We've got a lot of picks you can choose from.
There's a lot of really good college football movies in NFL as well.
Of course, since you have no football to watch, you have no excuse not to log on to RazorbackReels.com right now and vote for the Silver Reels Awards. We have so many different categories, you know, horror, action, drama, you know, actor, catchphrases. Tell us what you think about 2008 in the world of movies, and we'll broadcast your ceremony here in the studio on February 23rd at 8 p.m. You have until, you know, February, I think the cutoff was 18th or 19th to vote, so please do it right now. So hey, thank you so much. Thank you to Fiesta Square, AMC Fiesta Square.
If you haven't seen all the movies on the Silver Reels, you can go see Milk, you can go see The Wrestler, Slumdog Millionaire. They're all there right now, so check them out.
We'll see you next week. I'm Adam Roberts.
And I'm Aaron Emsall.